Bishop Barron is number one Amazon best-selling author and has published 16 books. I don't know how he's any time. He's created the groundbreaking documentary Catholicism, which is aired on PBS, and has 8 other films and study programs. He's the religion correspondent for NBC and has also appeared on Fox and CNN and other channels that we've all been on, the members of Congress, I should say. And he's spoken, as I said before, to Facebook and Google and Amazon, and now to the United States Congress. Ladies and gentlemen, Bishop Robert Barron.
John, thank you very much. John, God bless you.
Thank you. Congressman Tom and Congressman John, thank you so much for that really kind introduction. And I remember that night very well. When we all for dinner in Georgetown, and we had a very spirited conversation about a lot of things. And then this idea came up. And I said, well, if you can pull it off, I'll come and speak to whoever wants to come and hear me. So this is the fruit of that conversation long ago. Delighted to be here in this beautiful room, spectacular with the view of the Capitol. Washington means a lot to me. I was a student here many years ago. I spent 3 years at Catholic University up in Northeast. And really, a lot of my intellectual and spiritual formation took place there. And I think back, many of the paths that I've taken started in Washington. Didn't have a car in those days, but I took the metro every place. And so whenever I come back to Washington, it does feel like coming home. So that's a nice thing for me. And I tell you, the opportunity to speak to you today and to speak on this topic of the conversation between religion and politics is something I take with great seriousness. Here's what I'm not going to do today. I'm not going to talk at all about hot-button issues. Not because I don't think they're important. They are, obviously. So whether it's, you know, classically abortion, or now it's probably gender rights, or it's gay marriage, etc. These are the issues that we often talk about when religion and politics meet. Serious people engage in those conversations. They're important questions. But see, my concern is that when we rush right away to the hot button issues, we miss sometimes those really deep and abiding points of contact between what I call the spiritual tradition and the political tradition. Ways that religion can inform what lawmakers are doing. And so that's my concern today, is to talk about that. Bracketing, if you want, for a moment the hot button issues to get to some deeper things that might be a basis for an ongoing conversation. So that's my approach today. Let me start with this. I give a lot of retreats to priests and talks to priests. Something I very often do is I'll say, as we get started, could I ask you to go back in your imagination to when you first heard the call? So go back before all the concerns and anxieties and critiques and challenges of the present moment, go back to when you first heard the call to be a priest. And I say to them, chances are, when you recover that moment, you found a time of enormous grace, inspiration, and spiritual clarity. And that finding that moment, remembering that time, is decisively important for the successful carrying on of the work you do now. And I often draw them to a particular scene from a film. It's not a very good film, to tell you the truth. It's a film about St. Francis of Assisi. And it's called Brother, Son, Sister, Moon. It goes back to the 1960s. Donovan did the soundtrack, which will give you a sense of how it's a little bit dated. But there's a scene in that movie I've always liked. It's the scene when Francis and his first followers, there were 12 of them, arrived in Rome to the papal palace. And Francis and his brothers were seeking approbation for this new order of theirs. So into the grand papal palace comes this little band with their unkempt hair and their threadbare habits and their bare, dirty feet. And they make their way very tentatively into the splendor of the papal palace. And the room is filled with cardinals and archbishops and courtiers and hangers-on, all in their resplendent robes. And then at the very far end of the room, on this high dais, sits the Pope. And the Pope in question was Innocent III. By the way, one of the most important figures in the Middle Ages. Great figure in many ways. Francis enters. Oh, by the way, and Innocent III in this movie is played by the great Sir Alec Guinness. So about 7 years before he played Obi-Wan Kenobi, he played Innocent III. So in come Francis and his followers. They kneel down, and Francis commences to read very awkwardly from a Latin text. Well, it's true, the historical Francis was barely literate in his native Italian dialect. He could hardly read Latin. So sure enough, he's kind of stumbling and mumbling his way through the text. And all the archbishops and the courtiers are kind of exchanging knowing glances, you know, this poor bumpkin coming into the Pope's presence. But finally, in frustration, Francis casts the text aside. And kneeling before the Pope, he begins simply reciting the words of the Sermon on the Mount. Now, mind you, he's not commenting. It's not a sermon, not a gloss or anything. He's simply, from memory, reciting the words of Jesus about poverty, humility, simplicity of life, love of enemies, radical trust in God's providence. Just reciting the words of Jesus. But as he does so, the room begins to murmur and mumble, and people exchange glances and they frown at him. And how dare he do this in the Pope's presence, speak the words of Jesus. Finally, he reaches the climax of his speech, saying, you know, consider the lilies of the field. Not even Solomon in all his splendor was arrayed as one of these. At which point, they all rise up, they send the sergeant at arms, and they carry Francis and his friends bodily out of the papal palace. At which point, Alec Guinness, so Innocent III, who had been covered in this cope that was so elaborate and jewel-encrusted, it looked like a coffin, he takes off the cope, and then he dramatically raises his hand as though he's calling on a higher power. And he says, call them back. And so with that, they go out and they find Francis and his friends and they bring them back into the Pope's presence. At which point he begins this very slow descent of the great staircase. And he comes down from his height to the level of the holy man. He takes him by the hand and he says, when I began as a young priest, I was like you and your followers. I was filled with simplicity and enthusiasm and high idealism. And then he's still holding his hand. He says, but as you can see, years of church governance and administration have largely extinguished that early light. At which point, the Pope, who had been up on this raised dais, covered in this jeweled cope, now kneels down, and you hear the room gasping in shock. He kneels down and kisses the dirty, bare feet of St. Francis. Now, you see why I like that story, that scene, because it's exactly what I asked these priests to do. Remember when you first heard the call, when you first heard the summons to be a priest, back behind all the concerns, anxieties, and cares, and so on, of the present moment. Go back to that time, and you will find, I wager, a moment of extraordinary clarity and spiritual power. Okay, here's the point I'm going to make today, everybody. I think that principle and that scene has to do not just with priests, but with everybody in this room. This sense of being called, summoned, sent on mission, I think applies to everybody in our culture, including everybody in this room. And to recover the time when you first heard it what it was like when you first felt the summons to do what you're doing will be for you too a moment of extraordinary clarity and spiritual power. Now, let me explain this to you, if I can, by appealing to a very classical philosophical principle. So I'll put my philosopher's hat on that I first put on when I was a student here in Washington many years ago. The ancient philosophers, they're echoed by all the medievals and many of the moderns too, talk about the three transcendental properties of being. I know that sounds desperately abstract, but actually it's a very simple thing. It means wherever you find existence, you're going to find these three things. Whatever is, in the measure that it is true, beautiful, and good. So the truth, goodness, and beauty, the transcendental properties of being. Whatever is, in the measure that it is true, good, and beautiful. How come it's true? Well, because it corresponds to an inquiring mind. The medievals said, ens est scibile, just means being is knowable. So whatever is, so think of this room and all of its elaborate complexity is appealing to the mind. It's full of truth. Any scientist or any designer, any artist would be interested deeply in this room. But think of even the simplest thing, the simplest element is appealing to the mind. It has something true in it. In a similar way, whatever is, in the measure that it is beautiful. Be talk for another day to elaborate that, but it has integrity, harmony, and radiance, the medieval said. Splendid things like this room, indeed, but even the simplest thing, in the measure that it is beautiful and appeals to the soul. Finally, whatever is, in the measure that it is good. Why? Because it appeals to the will. It appeals to the desire. Now, the highest goods, yes, indeed, think of the best things in life. They appeal to the will. They call it forth. But even the simplest thing, in the measure that it is good. It appeals to the desire, the longing of the heart. Whatever is good, true, and beautiful. And you say, okay, so far, so abstract. But listen, all of culture is predicated upon the three transcendentals. All of culture and all its expressions is predicated finally upon the three transcendentals. Think, for example, now of the work of writers, researchers, professors, philosophers, scientists, investigative journalists. What are all these people interested in? What are they passionate about? But the truth. They want to know the truth. They want to discover the truth. They want to propagate the truth. That whole dimension of culture is predicated upon the great transcendental of the true. Now think of artists, poets, painters, creative writers, screenwriters, filmmakers, sculptors. They're preoccupied with the second transcendental, the beautiful. They want to discover beauty. They want to express and create beauty. They want to propagate beauty. They're passionate for the beautiful. You know what comes to mind here? One of my great heroes, the Irish novelist James Joyce, who as a young man considered the priesthood for a time. He knew about vocation or call. Decides not to become a priest, but then read his great novel, The Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man. What is that book but the story of an artist discovering his vocation? It becomes clear to Joyce that his whole life should be about, as he put it, the reporting of epiphanies. Isn't that beautiful? An epiphany, a manifestation of the beautiful. And his vocation would now be for the rest of his life. And he lived it radically, by the way, would be to report epiphanies. So all these people in this aspect of culture are under the aegis of the beautiful. I now come to everyone in this room. The third transcendental is the good, or the just, or the righteous. Much of the culture is predicated upon truth, much of it upon beauty. You're part of it. Think now of law enforcement officers. Think of lawyers and judges. Think of city councilmen and councilwomen. Think of representatives and senators, Supreme Court justices, presidents. What animates that work but a passion for the good, for the just, to find it, to fight for it, to propagate it? It's a passion for justice that lies at the bottom of the soul, I would argue, of everybody in this room. Now, day-to-day concerns, I get it. I mean, I'm in the midst of a lot of day-to-day concerns in my life. But find that point when you first heard the call. Can I rely here on the Protestant theologian Paul Tillich? Tillich said this: as you search for the truth, you have already been grasped by the truth itself. That's what I'm talking about here. The passion for the truth itself has already grasped you and now sent you on mission. As you seek to name and create and propagate the beautiful, you have already been seized by a passion for the beautiful itself. Everyone in this room now, as you seek justice, righteousness, the good in the public order, you have already been seized by justice itself. It's already called you, stopped you in your tracks, claimed you personally, and sent you on mission. Now, here's the hinge, if you want, of my whole talk, this next point I want to make. I'm speaking out of my own Catholic tradition. In Catholic theology, truth itself, goodness itself, justice itself are simply names for God. You know, by the way, a mistake that atheists, both old and new, always make is they assume that God is sort of one true thing among many. So a lot of true things I can take in with my mind, God must be one of these true things. That's not it. God is the truth itself. God's not one good thing among many, but God is goodness itself. God's not one just state of affairs among many, but God is justice itself. And so when you find the moment in your life when you were seized by a passion for justice, I would say you were called by God at that moment. Now, what's your whole life about? This is everybody in this room. What's our life about? It's bringing our lives into harmony with the integrity and beauty of that call. That everything I do is about serving justice. When that makes me unpopular, yeah. When that makes me less rich than I could be, yeah. When that means I might be attacked, yeah. The way you measure life now is how do you respond to this call from unconditioned justice? I think, brothers and sisters, when you find that place in you, you found this holy place that will then animate the rest of your life. Okay, now with that little interpretive move in mind, can I turn to a couple of texts in the Bible? You know, there are a number of, I call them master themes in the Bible. When you say what the Bible's all about, and I can name that in a couple different ways. But one way I would name it is along these lines. What the Bible is all about is the response to the divine call. God speaks. How does Israel listen? God speaks. How do we listen? God speaks, and do we obey? Obedire just means to hear, to listen. So I've just chosen a couple of famous stories from the Old Testament about the divine call. And I hope they speak now to all of you in this room. First one is from the third chapter of 1 Samuel. By the way, I think the Samuel literature, I always tell people you want to start with the Bible, start with the Samuel, 1 and 2 Samuel, because they're so rich in narrativity and in psychological depth and theological perception. But this is the famous story of the call of Samuel. Listen how it begins. Now, the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days, and visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. Now, I think the first thing the Bible wants us to see here is this is a symbolic portrait of a people grown indifferent to the things of God. So these metaphors of blindness, Eli can't see, visions were rare, people didn't hear the word of God. Is it because God had stopped speaking? I would say no. It's that people had lost the capacity to take it in, to understand the divine dimension of their lives. May I just suggest, everybody, not unlike our own time. Something I've been tracing for a long time is the rise of the nuns, you know, the N-O-N-E-S in our culture, those that say I have no religion. When I was a kid back in the 1970s, you know what the figure was in our country? It was 3% of our country would have claimed no religion. There was a Pew Forum study, just came out about 10 days ago. It's now 26% in our country. Now, I'm not saying, you know, everybody was a saint back in the 1970s. Trust me, they weren't. But are we losing a sense of the sacred and divine dimension of life? I think demonstrably yes. You know, the philosopher Charles Taylor talks about the buffered self. I've always liked that description. He means a self that's got a buffer zone around it. It's buffered from any contact with the transcendent. Well, that's how this story opens. Eli's blind and visions are rare. People don't hear anymore. Or, you know, this happens to us in the course of our lives when we forget that moment when we were called by justice itself to do his work. We've grown deaf and blind to it. Now, what happens next? Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli, thinking it was the old man who had called him. First great point. God, justice itself, calls us personally. It's a great biblical insight, it seems to me. That we can't simply live in these sort of grand abstractions of tribe or nation. We are addressed personally by God. And what matters is how we respond. You know, something I like very much in the Catholic Mass, right in the middle of the liturgy, we have to stand up and we recite the creed. But we all say, "I believe." Even though we're all there together, we're all saying it together, but nevertheless, each person has to say, "I believe." In other words, I've heard the word, and now I am going to respond to it. God called, I would say, each of you in this room by name. And all that matters is how we respond to that summons. So Samuel first thinks it's Eli. So he goes to him. The old man says, no, I didn't call you. Go back to bed. And the Lord called again, "Samuel, Samuel." And again, he goes to Eli and he says, "Son, I did not call you. Lie down again." And then a third time, "Samuel, Samuel." What's one of the signs of the divine voice? And this is true whenever people are discerning a vocation. This is a classic criterion. But one of the signs is persistence. Right? Think of all the voices we hear, all the things that beguile us, and they come and they go. You know, "Hey, I want your attention. Hey, no, look over here." There's something about God's voice. It's persistent. Again and again, in season and out. When we're ready to hear, when we're not ready to hear. When we respond well, when we don't respond well. God continues to call. What is that deep, persistent, abiding, personal call to do the work of justice? That's God's voice. Finally, after the third time, Eli understands. And he says to Samuel, when you hear the call again, go and say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. I'm thinking right now of several Elis in my own life. When I was a kid, elders who helped me discern the call. I've got them right now in my mind's eye, several of these priests that I knew, who helped me sort through what was happening to me. I remember a teacher of mine in high school, layman, and we kept a journal in English class. We had to write something every day, whether it was just a kind of a diary entry or a poem or a story, whatever, but we had to write something every day. And then we gave it to him. And it came back with his commentary. I didn't write one little thing that was explicitly religious, I remember. But he wrote in the margin, and I still, it's burned in my memory. He said, have you ever thought about the priesthood? And I don't know what it was, honestly, that he saw. But he was like an Eli to me. He was helping me discern what this call was about. Here's my guess, everybody. I bet all of you could think of an Eli in your life. There was some elder, some man, some woman, some elder who helped you sort that through and to say, yeah, I'm going to follow the path of justice. That's going to be my life's work. I'm going to become a servant of the call of justice. Maybe thank God for that Eli right now that helped you get on the right path. Without Eli, there'd be no Samuel. Without Samuel, the history of salvation would not have proceeded. Without Samuel, there's no King David. See, what's the Lord calling you to, all of you? What does he call? Why did he call you into this life? I bet there's an Eli that helped you with it. Can I go to a second one now? This one from the book of the prophet Isaiah. I'm at the sixth chapter, which is the account of Isaiah's call. You know, in these stories, everybody, I think they're wonderful for all of us to revisit, because they're talking about us, about what's going on in our hearts. Here's how it starts. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Here's the first thing I love about this, is Isaiah remembers exactly when it was. So he's describing when he got his prophetic vocation, when he knew what his life was about. And it was the year that King Uzziah died. In other words, it was burned into his memory because it was the defining moment of his life. See, and that's what I'm asking everyone to do in a way, is recover what was for you the year that King Uzziah died. What was the year? What was it like when you heard the call to become a servant of justice itself? That's a holy moment. You know, for me, I've told this story before, but I was a Catholic kid going to Mass on Sunday, but I wasn't interested in the priesthood at all. I was a baseball player. I wanted to be shortstop for the Cubs when I was about 14. And then one day, it was the spring of 1974. I'll put it in this context, the year that Richard Nixon resigned, the presidency. That's when a young Dominican friar taught us one of Thomas Aquinas' arguments for God's existence. And to this day, I don't entirely understand why, but it lit this fire in me. The year King Uzziah died, I know exactly what that was in my own life. What was it in yours? But what did he see? I saw the Lord sitting on a throne high and lofty. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. And one called to the other and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. Now, all these symbols. He's on a high and lofty throne. That means the experience was of something transcendent to the ordinary. not the world that he customarily lives and moves in, the world of wealth and power and pleasure and honor, the usual things that beguile us. It was something other than that. And see, that's exactly what the angels are saying in this great story. It's translated here appropriately as holy, holy, holy. And that, of course, comes up in all the great liturgies, Latin, sanctus, sanctus, sanctus. But the Hebrew is kadosh, 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 which means other, other, other. And see, it's a marvelous moment. And to find that in your own life is a marvelous moment. When the other broke into your life, again, what stands beyond wealth and power and pleasure and honor and all the usual things that we're intrigued by? When the unconditioned good and true and beautiful broke into your life and claimed you and sent you on mission, that's the sacred moment he's talking about. I love this, and it's making more sense to me now that I live in California. The pivots on the thresholds shook at the voices of those who called, and the house was filled with smoke, earthquakes and fires. I get that. But see, those are both classic religious symbols, aren't they? The shaking of the foundations. Paul Tillich has a great book of sermons called just that. Because see, what I'm standing on, I'm cocky and confident, I know what I'm doing, I'm standing here. But then when the foundations shake, that means the unconditioned has broken into your life. And it's upset your usual way of thinking, your usual way of acting. And then the smoke that fills the house. That's why, by the way, in Catholic liturgy and some of the other more liturgical traditions, we fill churches with incense during the liturgy. How come? Because it's meant to frustrate these eagle eyes of ours. Right? That look out and they see and they control and they manipulate and I got it, I'm under control. No, so when smoke gets in your eyes and you can't see right, or it obscures what's normally evident to your vision, that's see good. That means something other than your ordinary experience has broken through. That's what Isaiah is talking about. Now, the great spiritual masters say that the first step in the spiritual life is finding the center. Now, see that in masters of ancient and modern. Same idea. To find the center, that means to find this pure, unconditioned call around which the whole of your life now should be gathered. Does that make sense? Kierkegaard, the great Lutheran philosopher, said, a saint is someone whose life is about one thing. Remember that from that old movie, the Billy Crystal movie, City Slickers? Remember that when, who was the old cowboy, the old wisdom figure? Jack Palance, remember? And they said, he said, you know, what's it all about? And Palance said, he said, it was about your finger? No, it's about the one thing. See, but that's an ancient spiritual principle. The center is the one thing around which the whole of your life should revolve. You know, in the Lord's great story with Martha and Mary, that's what that's about. You know, Martha, Martha, you are anxious and upset about many things, the Lord says. Mary is chosen, and the Latin there is beautiful. It says, the unum necessarium. She's chosen the one thing necessary. That's what happened to Isaiah. See, when God broke into his life and shook the foundations and smoke got in his eyes and he heard the angels saying, kadosh, 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 other, other, other. That's the moment when you heard the call to serve justice itself. Now, let the whole of your life, and I mean everything you're doing to this day, be organized around that center. Speaking of fire, remember last spring when Notre Dame Cathedral was on fire? And I studied in Paris. I did my doctoral work there, and I used to give tours at Notre Dame, and it means the world to me, that building. And it was heartbreaking. I was actually on some of the news shows talking about Notre Dame, and you know what concerned me the most? It wasn't the roof, as tragic as it was losing that. It was the prospect of losing the rose windows, which I loved. And they were always the centerpiece of the tour I would give. Well, and thank God they were preserved. But you know what it is about the rose window? They're not just pretty pictures, but they're images of what we're talking about here. Because at the center of the rose is always a depiction of Christ, right? Of the divine, of the sacred. And then think of all the medallions that are arranged around the center as all the aspects of your life, right? Your mind, your will, your passions, your friendships, your public life, your private life, everything. They should find their place around the center, which is the call of God, the summons of God. Now let your whole life be organized around that center, and you'll find integrity, right? Integritas, your life will hold together properly. Okay, so that's find the center. Now listen. And I said, woe is me, I'm lost. For I'm a man of unclean lips. I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Beautiful moment. In the Bible, when do you know you're a sinner? You know you're a sinner when you're standing in the light, right? It's not like, well, I better get my sin figured out and then maybe God will pay attention to me. No, that's not biblical at all. It's rather grace breaks through. The light shines. The angels sing, right? And in light of that experience, you know that you're a sinner. Isaiah knows his life is off kilter. When he says, I'm a man of unclean lips, among a people of unclean lips. It's just biblical jargon for I'm a bad man, and I'm living among all kinds of bad men and women. I mean, who am I that I should receive this? Friends, listen, the second great spiritual path the masters talk about is knowing you're a sinner. I mentioned already those four great distractions: wealth, honor, pleasure, power. Those are the big four, says Thomas Aquinas. The things that we typically substitute for God. Everyone in this room, we've all got one or more of these poisons. Believe me, we all do. Meaning we tend to organize our lives around one of those big four. You know, I'm unhappy, but I'll be happy if I just get enough wealth. I don't have enough now, God knows. But if I get enough, I'll be happy. Or, you know, I'm unhappy. That goes without saying. And it's because I don't have enough power. But when I get enough power, I will be happy. I'm unhappy, God knows, but I'll be happy when they finally give me the honor I deserve. See, that's the way that the sinful soul typically operates. It wants one of these four. See, we're not wired for that. We're wired to follow the call of God. Even when it costs us wealth, pleasure, power, and honor. I'll speak out of the Christian tradition. Whom do we hold up before our eyes all the time? But the crucified Jesus. I remember years ago, I was on a retreat, and my own retreat director said to me, look at the cross of Jesus and ask yourself, how's he doing in terms of wealth, pleasure, power, and honor? When you figure that out, you'll know the right path, right? So Isaiah, understanding he's a sinner, man, is that important. Otherwise, our sin will trip us up, right? That as I'm trying to serve justice, I'm going to be beguiled by one of those big four, and I'm not going to be justice's true servant. To know you're a sinner, that's the second great spiritual path. Look how beautiful. What's the Lord do? Then one of the seraphs, and by the way, the seraphim, that means those who are on fire, right? Because they're closest to the divine light. That's why we associate saints with halos and light, right? Because they're close to the divine source. One of the seraphs, it says, flew to me holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, now that this has touched your lips, your guilt is departed and your sin is blotted out. Good. What's God interested in? See, God wants his grace to come flooding into the world. How's he want to do it? By calling us to serve truth and beauty and goodness. What blocks us? Our sin, our preoccupation with these four things. So what does God want to do? He wants to burn that away. So it's beautiful. It's not a punishing fire here at all. Don't read it as punishing. It's a cleansing fire. It's a purifying fire. See, so name your poison. We've all got it. We've all got it, everyone in this room. What is it? And all the Lord wants to do is purify us of this distortion. So that what? And here we come to the third great path in the spiritual life. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? Who will go for us? And I said, here I am. Send me. Now we're talking. There's the spiritual life. You find the center. Your life is now organized around the passion for justice. You know you're a sinner. You name the poison. You know what's keeping you from serving justice. And once you've been cleansed and purified by God's grace, now, it's not a cocky sort of arrogance here at all. It's a spiritual confidence. Here I am. Send me. Third spiritual path, realizing your life is not about you. Now, I know everybody, we're all sinners in this room. This is really a hard lesson because we, from the time we're kids, we're taught, no, my life is about me. Of course it is. It's about making me as wealthy and powerful and full of pleasure and honor as I can get. No, your life is about being sent by justice itself on mission. And once you're purified, you can say, Lord, here I am. Here I am. Send me. Find the moment in your life, the year the King Uzziah died, find the moment when the Lord broke into the temple and revealed his glory to you, the time he purified you and sent you on mission. That's the moment that will keep you alive. Okay, I wanted to make a couple more moves with you today. Can I make this a little more specific for those in this room, those involved in the work of law making? I want to appeal here to the person I've mentioned a couple times now, my intellectual hero, St. Thomas Aquinas. If you look in the second part of Thomas's great Summa Theologiae, the summary of theology, in that second part you'll find a densely textured philosophy of law, an account of law, which I've always found very compelling. Thomas talks about three types of law. Namely, positive law, natural law, and eternal law. And they exist in a kind of Russian doll or nesting sort of relationship. So first of all, positive law, what you're all concerned with every day, more than anyone in this country, concerned with positive law, meaning the formulation of those statutes by which a society is governed. Those are the positive laws. Whether it's tax laws or traffic laws or foreign policy, anything in between. The positive laws of a country. Aquinas says, positive law, if it is to be just, must be grounded in what he called natural law. Now, what's natural law? It's the moral law, which is predicated upon the perception of certain basic goods, which are evident to reason. So Thomas says, for example, life, basic good. Friendship, it's a basic good, meaning it can't be reduced to anything else. It's a fundamental good. Art, beauty is a fundamental good. Play is a basic good. Justice, knowledge, religion, a sense of the transcendent. Those are all objective moral values that appear to reason. Think of the Catholic philosopher Dietrich von Hildebrand distinguished between the merely subjectively satisfying and the objectively valuable. What he means there, it's a simple distinction, but you know, I find spaghetti and meatballs subjectively satisfying. I like it, you know? Well, but I'd never dream of imposing that on anybody else or making a law requiring that everyone eat spaghetti and meatballs. That's merely subjectively satisfying. However, Hildebrand said, there's this category of the objectively valuable, and I've just named some of them. These values that appear in all of their splendor, and the moral life is properly structured around them. Those acts that integrate and propagate the basic goods are good acts. Those acts that are repugnant to them, we characterize as wicked acts. Aquinas' point, just positive law must be grounded in this natural or moral law. But then finally, and this is the point I've been making so far, finally, the natural law, Thomas says, is grounded in the eternal law, which is identical to the mind of God. The same mind that governs the physical laws of the universe also governs the moral realm. When the natural law is grounded in the eternal law and the positive law is grounded in the natural law, we're dealing with just law. Notice, please, the final orientation is toward the service of justice itself. That's the divine mind. Now, lest you think, okay, that's a lot of medieval abstraction, Thomas Aquinas and the three types of law. Can I make it a little more concrete and a little more American for you? Go back now to the spring of 1963, April to be precise. Martin Luther King is leading his nonviolent protests in Birmingham, Alabama. And per usual, he was arrested for his efforts. And he was thrown into the somewhat squalid Birmingham City Jail. Friends of his smuggled, he had no paper to write on, they smuggled newspapers and envelopes in. And he commences to write from that jail a famous letter. It was in response to white Christian ministers who had challenged King, who had said, you know, we like what you're doing. Your goals are good, but your means are really questionable. And you're pushing the society way too fast, and you gotta slow down. So King, literally scribbling in the margins of newspapers, commences to write this little letter. I've got it here. They had said to him, I mean, how can you be advocating the breaking of laws? This is just, you know, it's repugnant to civil society. So here's King. One may well ask, how can you advocate breaking some laws and obeying others? The answer lies in the fact that there are two types of laws, just and unjust. And I would agree, this is Martin Luther King, I would agree with St. Augustine that an unjust law is no law at all. He goes on. Now, what's the difference between the two? How does one determine whether a law is just or unjust? Listen now. A just law is a man-made code that squares with the moral law and with the law of God. An unjust law is a code that's out of harmony with the moral law. To put it in terms of St. Thomas Aquinas, an unjust law is a human law that is not rooted in eternal law and natural law. I mean, can you get any more American than this letter from Martin Luther King written from the Birmingham City Jail? But he goes right back to Thomas Aquinas, which is to say, right back to the biblical inspiration. Just law is rooted in the moral law, which is finally rooted in everything I've been talking about today. When we feel called by justice itself, to be the servant of justice itself, when our work in making law is grounded in that vocation, then the laws that we make are just laws. How wonderful, you know, this little edition I got here, it has the letter, but also it has the I Have a Dream speech. And this morning I was out at the Lincoln Memorial, one of my favorite places to go, and thinking, of course, of King, who delivers the speech from the steps of that memorial and says this. So I say to you, my friends, that even though we must face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream that one day, this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. Now, King writes the letter from the Birmingham City Jail, April 1963. This is August 1963, a few months later. See, what's he saying here? He's advocating on the steps of Lincoln's Memorial for a change in the positive law in our country. He wants to get rid of the Jim Crow laws. He wants to change positive law. But what's he grounding it in? But precisely these great moral values of justice and equality. But then wait, there's a third step. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. That little word created, I think, runs through our minds very quickly. We don't pay attention to it. But you know, it strikes you when you read the classical political philosophers. You read Plato, Aristotle, Cicero. Equality? Self-evident? I mean, au contraire. the inequality of people in beauty and courage and virtue and physical ability is taken for granted. In fact, the rightly ordered society for those great figures depends upon acknowledging the fundamental inequality that obtains. Why in the world would we think that equality is a great moral virtue? It's in that little word. Of course, Lincoln echoed it himself in the Gettysburg Address. King echoes it in 1963. All men are created equal. The ground of our equality, finally, is the fact that we're all equally children of God. You see the same rhythm. Positive law, grounded in natural law, grounded finally in the eternal law. Ones who, I think, make the just laws. How about one more step, and then I'll bring it to a close. You know, I mentioned Kierkegaard earlier. The saint is someone whose life is about one thing, who's found the center. Everything is organized around this one great passion for justice. Can I hold up as we close the man that the Catholic Church proposes as the patron saint of lawyers and politicians? Namely, St. Thomas More. Though he lived five centuries ago, his story remains, it seems to me, archetypal. And a beautiful exemplification of what I've been talking about today. Thomas More is born in 1478 in London. He's an almost exact contemporary of Martin Luther. And like Luther, he's a kind of a bridge figure between the Middle Ages and the more modern society. So born 1478. Son of a lawyer, undertakes classical studies at Oxford. He becomes, in time, one of the leaders in what's called the New Learning in the 16th century that recovered the classical Greek and Latin of the ancient authors. He considers, as a young man, priesthood very seriously. In fact, a very severe monastic form of priesthood, but decides in time to step away. He becomes active now in the political arena. Getting elected to Parliament. He represents a large swath of his hometown of London. During these years, he also raises a family and becomes a very prominent philosophical writer. We still read to this day his great Utopia, his great work of political philosophy. He's a friend of Erasmus, the greatest scholar of the time. In fact, Erasmus spends long periods at More's house in Chelsea. I love this detail that Erasmus's greatest work, the In Praise of Folly, right? The Encomium Moriae in Latin. But it's a pun, because it does mean indeed In Praise of Folly, but Encomium Moriae can also mean In Praise of More. So Erasmus had such an affection for Thomas More, and the two of them work closely together. He becomes a friend of the young Henry VIII. And you remember in his youth, Henry VIII had the aspiration to be a Platonic philosopher king. And he was full of that kind of high idealism. Didn't last long. More was a mentor to him and a teacher. His career reaches its apex when he's named Lord Chancellor of England under Henry VIII. So the highest non-royal position in the English government. This very good and decent and devout man had made it, if I can use a term from later centuries, to the top of the greasy pole of English political life. But his rise to power coincides almost exactly with Henry VIII's desire to divorce his first wife, Catherine of Aragon, to marry Anne Boleyn. When the Pope does not give a dispensation for this and Henry presses ahead anyway, Thomas More resigns his position as chancellor. Henry, as you know, eventually declares himself head of the church in England, and More continues his silent resistance to this. The king first tries to cajole him, didn't work. Then he threatened him. It didn't work. And then watch those big four. He took away all four of them: wealth, pleasure, power, honor. So he strips More of his wealth and his property. His power, he has no more influence in the realm. Pleasure eventually locks him into a squalid cell in the Tower of London. Honor, stripped of all honor. And still More didn't give in. And then finally, the king trumps up charges against him and has More executed. The famous words he speaks, and they are indeed, it's not just a dramatic flourish, he really did speak these words on the scaffold. sums up a lot of what I've been trying to say today. When Moore, facing the chopping block, says, I die the king's good servant, but God's first. Now, see, that's the voice of a saint who's moving in the realm that you move in. I die the king's good servant. He's in service of the king and the formulation of law. He's seeking the righteous. But he listened above all to the voice of God. There's a great scene, I'll close with this, in the movie Man for All Seasons, which is based on the life of Thomas More. Still my favorite movie. I saw it when I was a kid. I watch it pretty much every year on the feast of St. Thomas More. There's a small scene in it I've always liked. It's not one of the grand dramatic scenes. There are a lot of those in the movie, but this is a very small scene. Between Thomas More and Richard Rich. Now, Richard Rich is a young man newly out of Cambridge, and he's full of learning, and he's full of ambition. So he goes to the household of the very well-connected Thomas More, hoping to find a position at court, right, to be among the glitterati of the court of Henry VIII. More resists him. Finally, Moore says to Richard Rich, Richard, I have a job for you.
You do?
Yes, there's an opening in the local school. A teacher? You want me to be a teacher? And Moore tries to cheer him up. You might be a good teacher, even a great one. And Richard Rich says, and if I were, who would know it? And Moore says, yourself? Your friends, your pupils, God. Not a bad public, that. Now, what I love about that is it exemplifies beautifully the tension between the ego drama and the theo drama. The ego drama, we sinners all live it to varying degrees. The ego drama is the drama that I'm writing, I'm directing, I'm producing, and above all, I'm starring in. This is the Bishop Robert Barron show. It's on the road in Washington. Here are my bit players. I'm the center of this great drama. But see, remember that third spiritual path. Your life is not about you. It's about this kadosh, 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 this holy one, this other who's broken into your life. He's the director. He's the producer of this great drama, and he wants you to play a role, to be sure. But you come alive when you let go of the little petty business of the ego drama, and you surrender to the theo drama. See, that's listening to the voice. Remember that time, all of you, when you first heard the call, and I'll just say it, you know, honestly and bluntly, from God, to do the work of justice. Can you follow the theo drama and let go of the ego drama? Everything else will follow from that. God bless everybody. Thanks for listening today.